Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, friends. Can you hear me? Am I on, Leonard? Am I on? Okay. I'm Pastor Tony. I'm one of the pastors here. Pastor Jill will be officiating today. Both of us serve with you. Daughter of Leonard. I did not get to know him well. Only been here a little over a year. And what I've known, I know some of what you have shared with me. People refer to him, he's like one of the pillars out there in the church. He's not holding up a building, although he worked on it very much and did a lot of good for it. What he did was help out people, build them up in a quiet way, in a way that lasts and endures. The way we want to hold on to today. I appreciate the pictures and the sharing of that. Somebody lives as long as Willard did, that pretend to maybe focus on the end of his life and not realize that he had a full life. He touched a lot of lives, which are no longer with us. But for all that he was to us and what he was to others, what he is to Christ Jesus, the Savior, our Savior. We give thanks today. We lift up. We celebrate his life. We want to pay honor to him truly in the best way that we can. So in music and song, prayer, and in our own deliberations. I invite you in a time to share the song that he knew so well. If you do too, Amazing Grace, that you might begin to center your thoughts and just bring our hearts together and ask the Lord to take all of that and make it a worthy tribute to the life of Willard.
Thank you.
veil our thoughts, remembrances, be accepted of thy sight, Lord. As we gather and we remember the Lord's life and all that you've done to us. We offer thanks and praise in the name of Christ Jesus. I want to invite you to hear these words of Scripture, words of comfort and inspiration, words that Willard knew well, taught by someone, and thanks be to God for the one who ever taught him these words. And I know he taught them to his daughter, because it's her job to teach him the other people. And so all of you that know these words, invite you to, let's just say them out loud. If you learned them, if they're in your mind and in your heart, if you recite with me the Psalm of David, the 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. These are the words of the Lord for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let's pray. O eternal God, you have shared with us Willard's life. Before he was ours, he is yours. For all that he has given us to make us what we are. For that part in him that lives and grows in each of us. And for his life that in your love will never end. We give you thanks. And now, Lord, we gather together and ask that you be with us and comfort us in our loneliness and strengthen us in our weakness. And give us courage to face the future unafraid. And draw those of us who remain in this life closer to one another. Make us faithful to serve you and one another. And give us to know the peace and joy which is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord. I'm going to ask now Grant Sundgren to come up and share whatever you want.
My memory. I like the memory of me to be happy. I like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright sunny days. I like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun. Happy memories may I leave when life is done. I consider myself to be pretty lucky because I was fortunate enough to have many father figures in my life. I grew up with uncles who lived close by. I grew up with both my grandpas living in the same town. I grew up with a dad who showed me what it means to be a hard worker and provide for his family. All of these men are great role models who helped me become the man I am today. But one of them was the first one. One of them was the first father figure I had in my life, and that was Grandpa Willard. My mom and I lived with Grandpa and Grandpa the first 2 years of my life until my mom and dad married. And I think it's because of those first 2 years that I believe Grandpa and I had a special bond with each other. You see, Grandpa Willard is my hero. He's the man I look up to and want to live my life after. As most of you know, I'm an educator. I've been working in education for 16 years, which makes me feel old. While I was teaching technology at Billville Middle School, we would have a homeroom every morning. And during homeroom, we would do activities with the students to teach them life skills and kind of help them reflect on people who've been influential in their lives. One particular activity was to write a letter to someone who had influenced our life the most. And as a teacher, I was encouraged to participate along with the students. So this particular time, I participated, and apparently I kept the letter because I found it recently, and I'd like to read it to you today because I think it would be a great, paint a great picture of who my grandpa is and what he means to me. I did obviously add to it and make some changes in preparation for today, though. Dear Grandpa, here I am sitting at home in class, and we're doing an activity to write a letter to the person who was most influential in my life. Well, that's you. I can't begin to thank you enough for all the things you have done for me and taught me. I look up to you, and I try to model my life after yours. I strive to be kind, caring, hardworking, much like you. You have taught me so many lessons throughout my life, and some of the most impactful ones are family first. No matter what, family first. You have to work hard and earn what you want. And also, it's important to have fun and make memories. I believe the biggest reason you are the most influential person in my life is because of what you taught me about family. For the first 2 years of my life, you were the only father figure I had. Even when my dad came into the picture, you continued to be a great father figure for me throughout my life. I always knew if I had an issue or needed help, I could reach out to you. There are a couple of instances that come to mind. First of all, you helped me with my paper route after I got shot. Yeah, I loved that day, I bet Grandma loved that day when I came in and said, Grandma, I've been shot while I was delivering papers. I don't believe there was a day after that you weren't there to come help me deliver papers for my paper route. There were also all those times when you'd come over in the morning and drive me to junior high. Yeah, that's what the cool kids used to call it, not middle school. Every morning when I would he would drive me every morning when I was being nervous all the time and worrying all the time. I blame that on Grandma. One thing I will never forget is that you and Grandma never missed one of my softball games. In fact, when I shared my softball buddies that you had passed, many of them had mentioned how they remembered you from all of our games. I always loved seeing you and Grandma sit there in the lawn chairs while I was playing. You also taught me how to be a hard worker and to earn what you want in life. I will never forget mowing all those lawns of the rental properties that Mrs. Brown had. In fact, to this day, I love mowing. It's sickening, I know, but it's true. It wasn't until later in my life that it sunk into me that you actually did all those mowings, plus working a full-time job at Hornell. Perhaps the most impactful part of your work for Mrs. Brown was the relationships that you created with her tenants. Once I was able to mow by myself, I would always see you chatting it up with them, and they'd be so excited to see you when you come by. To be honest, I hope that's quite fair. I was doing all the work, but I always loved to go to Mrs. Brown's house with you and watch the cows in her pasture. Of course, that one day, Eric gave us quite a scare when he decided to walk home from there and not tell anybody. Thanks for McDonald's, I guess, right, Eric? There wasn't a job you said no to. If anybody from Mrs. Brown to the church asked you to do a job or fix something for them, you did it without hesitation. And honestly, I don't know if you ever paid for these jobs, but you did it no matter what because you just wanted to help out. In fact, I remember my grandpa painting and repairing all these pews one time, and I was helping. I was running around, but I remember him. I think there's a picture somewhere of that, too. Grandpa, you're a pretty fun dude. The competitions we would have at the bowling alleys with all the cousins were a blast. I think all the cousins, my brother and sisters would agree. It's always fun to be around Grandpa because it's quite easy to get him talked into getting us some treats, whether it be ice cream from Dairy Queen or donut holes from Daylight Donuts or taking us out to eat at the old Valentino's buffet after church. I loved our races around the house when I was a little kid. You know, for an old guy, you were pretty fast, or I was pretty slow, but probably a little both above. Of course, the most fun I had with you going to Husker football games. My first game with you was in 1992 versus Washington, which we lost, but it was the last home loss until the Callahan era. Shoot, now if I go to the Husker games, I'm surprised we get a win. My last game with you was in the 2018 season. Honestly, I don't remember who the rest played or what the score was, But what mattered to me was, I was having dinner with my grandpa. That's 26 years of memories we made going to Husker football games. Again, grandpa, I want to thank you for being such a great role model and influential person in my life. If it weren't for you, I would not be the person I am today. I hope that when I become a grandfather someday, that I can have an impact on my grandkids as you had on me. Until then, I hope I just make you proud of the man I am. I love you.
So we can see where he got his strength and his independence. Now, this is one of the reasons why he and his brother Lloyd were so very close, and they were so close. And he taught that closeness to his family as well. He taught that family's important, and that family's first, Jesus first, right, and family second. And he graduated, as we said, from West Point High School and served in the Army, and he loved to drive this Jeep, right? And he would used to drive the sergeant around, who was like this father figure to him, and he would tell that story to his kids and his grandkids. He'd make comments for years, saying it'd really be fun to drive a Jeep again. When he'd see a Jeep, he'd say, you know, that just takes me back to when I used to get to do that. He would always keep the fire going when he was in the Army and keep everybody warm. And he had to leave one time, and the fire almost went out. His family said that back then, Crisco, right, that baking thing that you put in, was a really hot commodity, but they had to use it to get the fire back going when he got back, and the cook was mad at him. But they were warm, and that's the kind of person that Willard was. He wanted to spread warmth to other people and keep them comfortable. He said that when he was in 1945, he was in New York City, and he was there when the ball dropped on New Year's Eve, and he said it was so packed. He'll never forget that memory, looking around Times Square with all of the laughter and the lights and that glittery ball dropping. He would tell that story with such a smile on his face. And he spent a lot of his time at West Point, and that's why he was there for New Year's that year. But it was a cherished memory of his. Oh, he returned to Nebraska after he was discharged from the Army, and that's when he met his beloved Marjorie, because of his future brother-in-law, Dave. Now, Miller met David Midland. I don't want to get this story wrong. And Marjorie's sister, Wilma, was dating Dave. So then Dave went out to Marjorie's family farm, and he took Willard with him, and that's when he met Marjorie. And I can imagine that sparks flew immediately, because the rest was history. He was married to Marjorie for 67 years, and he adored her. Now, he graduated from Midland on August 4th, 1951, and then they got married on August 5th, right here at Fremont First. This church held a lot of memories for them. It was really special. Now, on the day that they were to get married, it was 105 degrees that day with no air conditioning. So you can imagine they were feeling good. So the minister looked over to Willard and said, I don't think Marjorie's feeling very well, meaning you need to take care of her. And Willard took care of his Marjorie all the rest of the days of those 67 years. In fact, one time Marjorie was laid up for 3 months because she broke her ankle. And when they brought her in the back door, she made this kind of giggle cry, right? Because she was so happy to be back with Willard, be back in her home. They were meant to be together, and they felt the absence when they were apart. We know that he's so happy to be with her now. Now, they built the very house that his daughter Julie and family live in today in 1956 over on Lincoln Avenue, right by that high school. But they said that when they built it, that high school wasn't there. It was a dairy farm. Can you imagine the progress and change that Willard saw right here in Fremont? And he contributed to that, to this community, because he loved this community. He loved the people. He wanted to see it thrive and grow. And we know that because of all of the time that he spent working and volunteering here in the community. He worked for Hormel for many, many years. He also volunteered for Habitat for Humanity. And he kept giving back to this town because he wanted to see it grow. He also worked odd jobs, we mentioned, for Oscar and Violet Brown. And Oscar passed away, and Willard kept helping Violet, including teaching her how to drive, because she didn't know how. And Violet would pay him to help, but his family said he just would have helped anyway, because that's the kind of person that he was. He was the kind of man that wanted to make sure that everybody was taken care of. He was a really calm person, especially when he was teaching new skills like driving. In fact, he taught his daughter Debbie how to drive. They told this story about how they were going down a hill and she didn't brake right away. You know, she's learning how to drive, right? And they zoomed down that hill, but Willard, he was calm that whole time. Not raising his voice like I would have done. Not grasping, probably, right over on the side. He just kept saying, it's going to be okay. He volunteered Habitat for Humanity after he retired, and he was a member of Fremont First United Methodist Church for 50 years. He was married here, he raised his family here, and his family is still active here today. Willard truly left a legacy for loving Jesus and for loving community. He did prayer and repair work for a while and even helped with these pews that we are sitting in today. We'll remember. Now, he was a quiet man, I was told, and he got an award here at church for an outstanding volunteer. And he didn't have a lot of words, but his family was so surprised because he spoke a little after he got that award. And I think it's because he cared so much for this church and these people. And he wanted them to know it. Because when Willard spoke, when he said something, you'd stop and listen. Because you knew that it was important. And you knew it was from his heart. Now, when Lynn, Julie's husband, first met Julie, told the story about how he'd come over to the family's house and Marjorie would just kind of talk away and chat away and Willard would just kind of sit there quietly. And then when Marjorie would get up and go to leave, he would just look over at Lynn and kind of smile and say, "Here you go." He was one of the few of the son-in-laws of those that he would go out and help bale hay and do things on the farm. Because he saw things that needed to be done and he would just do it because he was that selfless kind of person. He would even take Violet that we talked about a little bit earlier, but he'd take her to special nights when he and Marjorie and her would go to shows at Sarban, and that's not something he was paid to do. He wanted to do that. He wanted her to feel special and taken care of and seen and valued. He just cared about people. Now, Greg told the story a little bit earlier about helping with the paper route. And I love that because I know Willard also loved to walk. He would go for these long walks, right from Lincoln here, the Lincoln Street down to Military down to Bell, if you're familiar with Fremont, right? And then Bell is 16th, and then back home over by the high school. That's a long walk. But he loved being out in nature and feeling that cold air and the fresh air on his lungs, seeing the sights, seeing what this community was doing, being with the people. That brought him so much joy. And he loves helping with those paper routes. It was the best of both worlds for Willard. He got to walk and help. That was perfect. Now, as girls went to Nebraska Lessing for college, the older two, and they'd go down to Lincoln Gateway Mall and go shopping, of course. That was so fun. And Julie remembers that she and her dad would go down to the diner counter and they'd have coffee together. And Julie would get to have a soda, which was such a treat. And he always made sure that she had one. She'll never forget that. But we also know that Willard loved Nebraska football. In fact, he passed away the day that Matt Rule, our new coach, arrived in town as head coach. And I gotta be honest, I think he just wanted to make sure he was in the realm where Matt could hear him, right? So he could give him coaching advice. So those wins are coming, and we know that Willard's whispering in his ear. The last time he went to the game, as Greg said, it was in 2018. Memorial Stadium was such a happy place for him. He loved to go to those games. He went to one every year without clockwork. He used to cross his fingers and his arms and his legs, right, when he watched the game, like everything, just to bring it luck. And listen, they used to do that back when in the Tom Osborne era, so I think there's something to it. Now Lynn says that he's going to have to do the same thing, because when he did it, they did win, right, Lynn? So I think there's something to it. You know, Willard was a man who loved his family and loved God. And his daughter, Christy, remembers that Willard and his beloved Marjorie used to say the Lord's Prayer together. Every night before they went to sleep, she would hear them right through the wall. And that was their nightly ritual together. And so I think it's only fitting today that we say the Lord's Prayer all together. And we know that Willard is chiming in, hearing that while he's being held and celebrated by the angels and by Jesus. Let's do say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So at this time, back up. He's going to share a poem that was so close and dear to Willard and one of the family wanted to hear today as well.
Apparently I was supposed to do this now, not before, so I'm supposed to do that. My memory, I like the memory of me to be a happy one. I like to leave an afterglow of smiles when life is done. I'd like to leave an echo whispering softly down the ways of happy times and laughing times and bright sunny days. I like the tears of those who grieve to dry before the sun. Happy memories may I leave when life is done.
I don't think we can ever hear them enough, right? I think that's beautiful. I'd like to share a scripture from the book of John, chapter 14, verses 1 through 3. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself. And that where I am, there you may be also. A word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Oh, I don't think Willard needs a mansion. That wasn't the kind of man he was. He built his mansion here, right? With that beautiful home, with that legacy. But we know that he loves something comfortable and something familiar. And that's where he is. Somewhere comfortable and familiar. And we're so heartbroken to say goodbye to his time here with us on earth. And we'll feel those memories and we'll feel the absence of his physical presence. But we'll never feel the absence of his spiritual presence and his sweet soul that will always live on with us. So before I say a quick benediction here, the family would like to invite you to a little lunch downstairs that they've been preparing, and it's a time of just remembrance. We can share stories and just be with one another, because Willard would have loved that. He would have loved everyone being together, so we do invite you to come. And as you're there remembering and talking and laughing, because it's so good to be sharing in the joy with one another. Remember that Willard would be there, sitting quietly, but taking it all in. Let's pray. Father God, we are so grateful for your spirit and your presence. And God, we need you here today. God, we need you to hold us when we're broken. We need you to tap into your strength when we don't feel our own. And God, I especially pray that Willard's family feels that strength and that love, and that you're wrapping them in your arms, and so that they can feel your tender care. And God, today, as Willard's listening to Lauren's well and sitting with his Marjorie, God, help us to feel the peace that he feels and continue his love and his legacy of faith. We ask these things in your son's name. Amen. We do invite you to join us, beloved, and may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face upon you, and may you always feel his presence and peace. Go in peace, beloved. Thank you.